बारे में. Privacy protection and law. So the use of IT in business requires balancing the need of those who use the information against right and desires of the desires of the people who whose information may be used. On one hand, the information about people is generated, stored, analyzed, and reported because organizations can use it to make better decisions. Like an organization needs basic information about customer to serve them better. Like in Amazon, if you see, if you purchase a shoe, you know, of size 7 or 8, and after 2 years, if you again go back and purchase and search for a shoe, it will recommend you, you know, a shoe of size 8. So Amazon, you know, stores your data and your even size of your shoe and what kind of product you have purchased. So next time onwards, it will you know, recommend a so personalized way that you will remain a customer there. So on other hand, many object to data collection policies of government and businesses. So yeah, there is many groups and many people who object and who thinks that this is unethical to collect customers' data, you know, or people's data by the government or any other business organization. According to US census data, privacy is key concern of internet users and the top reason why non-users still avoid the internet. So yeah, definitely this is something to be concerned. Okay, then privacy protection and law, in this you can see some of the laws that are mentioned here. A historical perspective on the right to privacy. US Constitution took effect in 1789. So in 1789, the US formed their first constitution. Although constitution does not contain the word privacy, the US Supreme Court has ruled that the concept of privacy is protected by a number of amendments in the Bill of Rights. Okay. Supreme Court has stated that American citizens are protected by the Fourth Amendment when there is responsible expectations of privacy. To today, in addition to protection from government intrusion, people need privacy protection from private industry. That is what I was telling you. Few laws provide such protection. Very recent update in India is that Just Dial is going to be purchased by Mukesh Ambani's company. So why they are not purchasing? They are purchasing a big amount of share, and their condition is that they want to access the Just Dial database for their Reliance's business. Understand? So this is a kind of unethical thing with the general public whose data are collected by Just Dial. Now, recent history of privacy protection or communication, you can see Communication Act came in 1934 in USA, which restricted the government's ability to secretly intercept communication. Okay. But it is definitely in general case, in special cases, government definitely can intercept people's communication. So Pegasus is one of the issue recently going on in India. Like spelling is like this, I don't know, you need to check out. Okay. However, under 1968 federal statute, law enforcement officers can use wiretapping. So that is what I was telling you. The interception of टेलीफोन और टेलीग्राफ कम्युनिकेशन फॉर पर्पस ऑफ एफिनोइज और सर्वेलेंस इफ द फर्स्ट ऑप्टेन फ्रॉम द कोर्ट ऑर्डर. सो द एजेंसीज कैन डू इट विद अ कोर्ट ऑर्डर. दिस इज इम्पॉर्टेंट. FOI, the Freedom of Information Act, passed in 1966. So it is something like RTI in India, Right to Information. Okay, then prayer. Credit Reporting Act in 1970 regulates the operation, the operations of credit reporting bureaus, including how they collect, store, and use credit information. So in India also, you know, this is something issue. I know. You will find that if you have a good credit rate, credit rate means what? Whether if you take a loan. Whether you are repaying the loan within time or not. So, like who are uses credit cards. Credit cards are usually giving you loan for 1 month, right? So, whether if you are repaying your credit card bill within time or not. If somebody is doing it for a long time, then he or she will get a good credit score. And who have good credit score, they will find that they usually get call from different banks that we have this loan offer, this, that, offer, you can opt for it and all. Now, next comes Privacy Act 1974. Provides certain safeguard for people against invasion of personal privacy by federal agencies. The Central Intellectual Intelligence Agency, CIA, Central Intelligence Agency and law enforcement agencies are excluded from this act, nor does it cover the actions of private agency industry. Okay. Next comes COPPA Act. This is another act, the Children's Online Protection Act, was passed by Congress in October 1998. So according to COPPA law, the website that creates to children that caters to children must offer comprehensive privacy policies, notify their parents, guardian about its data collection practices, and receive parents' consent before collecting any personal information from children under 13 years of age. Okay. Then in 2004, Federal Trade Commission acquired, this is our case, Bonji Software and UMG Recording for collecting personal information from children online without their parents' consent and settled with them for a penalties of $75,000 and $400,000. So you can understand the settlement amount. Then these are something very important to that when you are going to take a service or you are going to purchase a software service or a cloud service, you need to know all these things. GDPR is the most important. GDPR is the most important when you are going to take any, you know, collecting data on your can I say on your system. Say many websites will find that when you open the website, immediately takes your permission that we are going to store our cookies on your browser. Are you agree? And if we find this message comes in such way, most of the time that message will block 75% of the page, and you have to accept, then only this window will go. So this is, I think, unethical, you know, being a, you know, something material is online, but forcing the users to accept the cookies before seeing the information or what is there in the on the website. Okay. So because you know, I say I am visiting a website, and before it is showing its content, it is asking me to take the and accept their cookies. Now I accept their cookies. After that, they allow me to enter into the website, and after entering, if we found that there is nothing useful for us. So what is the feeling we will get that the website cheated us to get accept their cookies. So there is many such things, many other data collections. So whoever is doing all these things, they need to follow the GDPR guidelines. This is very important to be GDPR compliant, General Data Protection Regulation. So this is basically from European Union. Okay. Building trust must be more strongly addressed within the internet corporations are assigned name and numbers. Internet corporation for assigned names and number. Okay. Regulatory framework. Okay, so these are different regulatory framework like common vulnerabilities and exposures. So this is a database which list all common vulnerabilities and exposures. Okay. Then FedRAMP is another organization who maintain all these things. Then National Institute of Standard and Technology, about NIST, they provide the standard for most of the computer and technology related things. This is again US. It is already written US Department of Commerce. Okay. Then Graph is another, then Center for Internet Security, another organization. So here GDPR highlights are that 6 GDPR principles. First one is lawful means. That means whatever data it is collecting, any organization or website is collecting, it must process all user data for a specific purpose clearly and truthfully stated and agreed to by the user. Okay, so if somebody is collecting data, it should clearly state that why it is collecting the data and where it's going to use all this data, and the company is supposed to, or the data collector is supposed to stay with the agreement, and they should not violate it. Okay, then purpose limitation, like when we put our data on Amazon, how many of you know that in how many ways the Amazon will use our data? Or when you are using Gmail, do you know in how many ways the Google can use your data, your emails data and your communication data? So these are very important things that many people, most of the people are unaware about all these things. Then purpose limitation, collect data for specific legitimate purpose only. Right. Process all user data for a specific purpose. You must gain explicit consent from the user for this. Then data minimization. Limit the amount of data. So don't collect all the data. So it should be as limited as possible amount of data it is collecting. Then data accuracy. So what data it is collecting, it must be keep up to date, ensure all data you store is accurate, up to date, and accessible. Ideally, users can securely update or delete their data themselves. That means, if say Amazon have given all your data to Amazon to create a customer account and purchase and all, and once someday if you feel that no, I should delete all my data from Amazon, it must allow to delete your account, and as well as, it should, when you delete your account, the Amazon must delete all backup it have kept of your data. Okay. Then data safeguarding. Processor must protect users' data against unlawful processing or loss, encryption, or privacy by design are required. Only keep data you need. That means the And the organization or companies must keep only those data who what they need, you know, to serve the customer, but should not keep all the data for one at a time, and should shoot down to protect user identity. So instead of keeping all real data, they can use pseudodoms. Pseudodoms are random identification or anonymity. They should add anonymity to the data so that if this data is going to be leaked sometime, the attacker will not be able to identify those person whose data it is. Then NIST cybersecurity framework overview. So NIST gives an overview of cybersecurity framework. First, it said identify. Identify what are the things organization need to identify: assets and asset management, business environment, governance, risk assessment. That means what kind of security risks are there regarding their data. Then risk management strategy. Once they know these are my risks, then what is the management strategy of the risk, right? After doing this first step, next is protect, right? How to protect. Then first one is awareness control, so that all the users should be aware what is security, how to protect it, the data, okay? Then awareness and training. So give training and educate the users, the stakeholders. Then apply data security like encryption and other things. Okay. Then information protection and procedures, maintenance, protective technologies to be used. Then number three is detect. You have to try to detect all the time if there is any malicious activity or some breach in the system or not. Like anomalies and event should be detected. Security continuous monitoring needed to detect any uncertain security events. Then detection process need to be developed. Okay. Number four is respond. If you detect that something is going on, something malicious is going on, then how to respond? So each organization must have a response planning, then communication, how to communicate, okay? Then analysis, mitigation, how to reduce the effect of the attack, right? Then improvements. Fifth is recovery. Recovery planning, that means once a malicious activity has been done and then detected, then the organization must have a plan for how to recover from that. Then improvement and communications. Okay, so this is you can say the relation between different organization, how they works for information security and cyber security and protection of data. Okay, so you can see here GSA, then Department of Defense, and US Department of Homeland Security, these three things together have a joint authorization board. So this is in prospect of USA. Okay. So these three things together have a joint authorization board. Okay. And on the other hand, there is office management and budget, and then CIO council is there, who does the cross agency coordination. Then NIST is there, who does all these standard and specifications. Okay. So keeping all these things together, this framework works. Okay. Then key privacy and anonymity issues. Most important issue is the identity threat. Occurs when someone steals key pieces of personal information to gain access to personal financial accounts. This information includes name, address, date of birth, SSN, passport number, driving license number, and mother's median name. You can understand that all these are easily available for anybody. Then 246,000 identity complaints in 2004. So in 2004, you can see a huge number of identity theft was reported. Then estimation number of victims is about 10 million per year. Now there is a technology of generating user information called NORA. So what they does, process of collecting large quantities of information and combining it to create profiles of individual. That means, say, Mr. X, he have Facebook account, he have say Twitter account, and have started in some school, colleges, and everywhere he have visited, he have left some of his information, in their system. Now, if somebody basically uses NORA and collects his data from social media, from security cameras and facial recognition using this, his images can be collected using this. Then clickstream, using some virus or malware, what website this person visits and what is the sequence of visiting the website, which pages they visits, all this called clickstream. Then commercial transaction like information collect from Big Basket or Amazon and other websites. Okay, then telephone record, then credit report. These are a little effort is needed. Anybody can collect about anybody. Okay, then mobile phone data, then incident and arrest system. Okay, so from all these sources, if somebody collects data and correlate them to detect that whether all these data are to a single person, against a single person. Once they correlate all these data, then they get huge data about a single person. So almost every data. Okay, so that is the reason it is saying create profile of individuals. They can create the full profile of an individual. Understand? Then hacking of large databases to gain personal identity information. What is this? Partial list of identities from this is from 2005. February 2005 checkpoint keeper of more than 19 million public record revealed that the hacker stole data on more than 147,000 customers. Okay, in March 2005, Reed Elsevier, the parent company of LexisNexis, announced that the hackers had compromised its massive database, stealing information on more than 300,000 people. So you can understand, this list is very long, every year it increases. So these are the things. Well, these are many report of data breaches happened. Yeah. Then approaches used by identity thieves. What are the approaches they use? First, they hack databases using phishing and spyware. So the hacking database is something, getting huge amount of people's data at a time. Phishing is, that is a one-to-one thing. Okay. So phishing is attempt to steal personal identity data by tricking users, entering the information on counterfeit website. This data includes credit card number, account username, password and SSN and all these things, and spoofed email lead consumers to the fake websites. And another is spare phishing. What happens in this, it is a variation in which employees are sent phony emails that look like that they came from high level executives within their organization. So employees are again directed to fake websites and then ask to provide a personal information. So this kind of thing happened with us also at NIT Patna. with many faculties, we had received fake mail basically from an ID, and this ID was created with a name which looks like our director's name, but it is not exactly the same name. It is some twisted name was there. Okay, and that mail was sent to many of the people, and one copy I had also received asking for some Amazon gift card. That attacker was writing that I immediately need some Amazon gift card. Can you please give it as I am out of station and I don't have my laptops and other devices to do it, so I have to send it to my some of my relatives. So people, at the first look will feel that okay, it is came from the real person. But immediately we found that one of the faculty forwarded that fake mail to our director sir, and he immediately replied to everybody that this kind of fake mail is received by many of faculty members. So please do not reply. You can see this is not my mail. Okay. So this is a quite common thing happens nowadays. These are many phishing examples. I'm not going into this. Then spyware. Spyware is a term for keystroke logging, logging software that is downloaded to user's computer without adequate notice, consent, or control for the user. So what happens when you are downloading something, say, most of the time it happens that when you are trying to download some document, some MP3 or video from third party website, it will ask you to download their own downloader. If you download it and install it, it is not going to work whatever you are thinking, expecting to do. Most of the time after downloading those things and installing, people forget to uninstall it. What happens? Those things can be spyware. Okay. So those programs can record all your keystroke and whatever you are doing on your system. It can copy many files and can send to the attacker. Spyware create a record of keystroke, that is what I have told you, entered on a computer, so it can read all the keystroke the victim is typing on his computer, enabling the computer account usernames, password, credit card numbers, and other sensitive information. Okay. Then identity theft, Assumption Deterrence Act. This is another act. Congress passed this Identity Theft and Assumption Deterrence Act in 1998 to fight identity fraud, making it federal felony punishable by a prison sentence of 3 to 25 years. Okay, the act appoints Federal Trade Commission (FTC) to help victims restore their credit and erase the impact of fraud. Then spamming is another thing, and you already know what is spamming. Sending unnecessary emails. Okay, spamming is the transmission of the same email message to large number of people. They are controlling the assault of non-solicited pornography and marketing act went into effect in January 2004, but you see act says that it is legal to spam. Anybody can send a large number of send messages to email to large number of people. It is legal. Okay, provide that messages meet few basic requirements. It is legal, but with a star. What is this star? Is it must meet some basic requirement. Not only has CIA spam act failed to slow a flow of junk email, but some believe that it actually has increased the flow of spam. Definitely, okay, it has given some guideline, and it is saying that if you follow the guideline, then you spam, it is not illegal. So people will do it, okay, because it legalize